From the opinion pages of the Wall Street Journal, this is Potomac Watch.
Donald Trump names Kash Patel as his choice for director of the FBI. Meantime, more trouble for Defense Secretary nominee Pete Hegseth as a report in The New Yorker alleges turmoil, including financial mismanagement at two veteran nonprofits that he ran. Plus, listeners weigh in with thoughts on Trump's cabinet choices. Welcome, I'm Kyle Peterson with The Wall Street Journal. We are joined today by my colleagues, columnists Kim Strassel and Bill McGurn. The latest Trump nominee to draw attention came in a Truth Social post on Saturday night, naming Kash Patel as Trump's choice to lead the Federal Bureau of Investigation. Here's part of what Trump said. Kash is a brilliant lawyer, investigator, and America First fighter who has spent his career exposing corruption, defending justice, and protecting the American people. He played a pivotal role in uncovering the Russia hoax, standing as an advocate for truth, accountability, and the Constitution. He noted that Mr. Patel served in his first administration, including chief of staff at the Department of Defense. But to my eye, one of the key lines here is America First fighter. And to that point, let's listen to Kash Patel speaking at the CPAC Conservative Conference this February.
When we wake up in November, it is not going to be just hope that pushes us across the finish line. We are going to look back together and say, we helped destroy the two-tier system of justice that is targeting Americans illegally. We helped destroy and identify an intelligence community that has gone rogue to seize our right to vote with their lies and fake disinformation campaigns. And we collectively joined forces to take on the most powerful enemy that the United States has ever seen. And no, it's not Washington, D.C., it's the mainstream media. And these people out there in the fake news. That is our mission.
Kim, what else do we know about Kash Patel, and what do you make of his nomination now to lead the FBI?
Well, he does have long experience in government. He is a lawyer. He was a public defender in Miami-Dade for 8 years. He also worked as a former federal prosecutor in the U.S. Department of Justice for about 3 years. He then went on to work for Devin Nunes, the congressman from California, who was very instrumental in unraveling that Russia collusion hoax. And while he was there as a lawyer for Mr. Nunes's office, played a big role in the first memo that Nunes put out that really exposed the shenanigans the FBI had gotten up to, exposed the degree to which the Hillary Clinton campaign had been involved in the manufacture of that fake dossier that was used against Donald Trump. In the Trump years, he was a chief of staff to acting Secretary of Defense Chris Miller, also deputy assistant to the president and senior director for counterterrorism at the National Security Council. So he's had history in the intel worlds, defense world, also the legal prosecutorial world, and on both sides, public defender and as a prosecutor. I think one of the questions that people have raised is nonetheless his experience in law enforcement, specifically the FBI. He certainly has a lot of experience of tangling with the FBI because during his time with Nunes's office, that was a big problem that they faced, a hurdle. The FBI was misbehaving and then basically covering its tracks. But in terms of understanding the kind of day-to-day job of special agents in charge and investigations, I think that's where some people in the Senate will end up having some questions.
This is a position that requires Senate confirmation, as Kim says. And Bill, I think she's right here that the management experience, the lack of direct experience inside the FBI is probably going to be something many senators are going to zero in on. And just to provide a sense of the scale, here is from the FBI's FAQ website. It says the FBI employs approximately 35,000 people, including special agents and support professionals such as intelligence analysts, language specialists, scientists, IT specialists. And Bill, even if you are of the view that the FBI needs deep reform, not just surface reform, but some kind of deep restructuring, it seems to me that similar to concerns that have been raised about some of Trump's other nominees, you would want somebody who has experience within that agency to carry out that kind of reform, because they're going to know where all of the policy levers are, they're going to know where all the pitfalls are, and they're going to be more successful in the end than somebody potentially who comes in as an outsider and maybe talks a big game, but doesn't have the experience inside the agency to know what's around every corridor in the HQ.
Yeah, I think you could actually make that critique of almost any appointee, that whatever federal bureaucracy they've taken over, no one has run something equivalent of that size before. So in some senses, that is a general critique. You know, unless you worked inside the bureaucracy, you don't have experience with that. The FBI is unique, I think. I have a prejudiced view. My dad was a career FBI agent. He's been very upset at the direction, which he thinks is contrary to how he was trained to be apolitical as an agent. He's really been disturbed by the amount of politicking and so forth. So one of the odd things about the FBI, if you're appointing a Marine commandant, generally you appoint a Marine. If you're appointing the chief of police in New York City, you appoint a cop. If you appoint the head of the fire department in Chicago, you pick a firefighter. But with the FBI, for some reason, they almost never pick an agent to run it. It's usually a lawyer who doesn't understand the culture. And so I share the view that the FBI really needs to be reformed, that there's a lot of problems with it, but there's also a good part of the FBI, and that needs reinforcing. And I would have picked a special agent in charge who runs one of the large field offices in like Chicago, Cleveland, Los Angeles or something. There's still a lot of good guys who are familiar with the culture. It doesn't mean that Kash Patel can't do it, but I think it's harder. And I think if you want to have the respect of the people you're going to lead, you have to kind of be one of them. And that's why I mentioned those other examples of cop leading police forces, firemen leading fire departments. And when you bring in a lawyer from the outside, I don't think they instinctively had it. Doesn't mean he can't do his job. I think it does make it a little bigger, because what we want is not just to shake it up, but we want to land back where it was before, with the culture of an apolitical culture and not what we've seen in the past years.
Hang tight. We'll be right back. Welcome back. A second thing that may come up in these confirmation hearings for Patel is his willingness, I think, to follow Trump into blind alleys and down rabbit holes. And let me tee this up with our first letter from a listener. Tom says, in regard to these Trump choices, he's hearing the term Trump loyalist used. And he wonders if that's a snide way of suggesting that people being nominated for administration jobs are only getting those jobs because of past loyalty rather than qualifications. Don't all new presidents appoint loyalists? And if so, why has the term rarely been used during incoming administration nomination periods before now? And Kim, I guess my response would be, I would frame it this way, that maybe there's a distinction between someone who is a loyal employee and someone who is a loyalist. And I would use Bill Barr as an example of the first. I think he was a loyal member of the Trump administration in carrying out his duties as attorney general, advancing the president's policies. But when push came to shove after the 2020 election, and there were rumors flying around about fraudulent ballots and so forth, he saw it as his duty to come out as the attorney general and say that he didn't see any evidence of anything that would have changed the outcome of the 2020 election. And the reason that I think Patel is being called a loyalist is that he has gone the other direction. He's reportedly one of the Trump allies that was behind the song Justice for All, recorded by January 6 inmates in jail that Trump played at some of his rallies. Patel is the author of a series of Trump-themed children's books, including one based off of the movie 2000 Mules. It is called The Plot Against the King 2000 Mules. Here's the Amazon description. Kash Patel tells the fantastical story of how two inquisitive minds, Dinesh and Debbie, search for the truth and uncover evidence of a terrible scheme to elect Sleepy Joe instead of King Donald. And not surprisingly, this has Trump's endorsement. Here's his quote on the Amazon page. This book should be in every school in the country. And notable that we're talking about it this week because Dinesh D'Souza, who is the narrator of the film 2000 Mules, has come out in the face of a libel lawsuit that he and the producers were put under. He is now apologizing, saying that surveillance video that was used in the film was not actually correlated with phone data in the film, apologizing specifically to a Georgia voter named Mark Andrews. But Kim, I wonder what you make of that distinction. I think all of this stuff would come up in hearings for Kash Patel. Does he really think that the 2020 election was stolen? And if he gets confirmed as FBI director, is that something that he is going to go through and try to investigate again?
I'm not sure I would make a distinction between loyal and loyalist. And I do think the reader actually has a point that I think the press does use the term loyalist as a pejorative when it comes to Republicans. I mean, look, you can look around and it's sort of funny. I would defy anyone to suggest that there isn't a single member of the Biden administration that isn't a loyalist by the definition that you certainly laid out here. I could make the argument that Merrick Garland has certainly proven himself more loyal to the president than he has to the duties of his office. And that's the real question is, I think you can be a loyal employee or a loyalist as long as your chief loyalty resides in your duties and your fidelity to the Constitution and to the people who you serve out there. Fundamentally, they are your bosses and the law as well. And I think that's the real question. Those are the questions that should be put to Kash Patel. I think more interesting to senators are going to be things like statements that he has made that would suggest that he has been on board at times with Trump's desire at times to seek Department of Justice employees that will engage in going after his opponents. But I also think that there's plenty of times that Kash Patel has talked about, and you heard it in the clip we heard earlier, about getting rid of two tiers of justice. I'm not sure those two things go together. And those are the questions I would hope that senators are asking him. Everybody does want the Department of Justice and the FBI to be returned to a state where we see an end of the politicization that Bill was talking about, these politically motivated investigations and lawsuits and prosecutions that follow. I think people are tired of it and they want to see an FBI and a DOJ that is once again getting out of politics, having that high bar for those sensitive investigations and essentially, you know, maintaining fidelity to the Constitution in who they go after and who they don't. And so I think those are the things that are going to be top of mind in Congress as they ask him the questions that need to be asked.